Yes, there is a word from the Lord. Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 21. Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 21. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. I want to ask you the question today, are you worth the investment? Would you look at the person next to you and ask them, are you worth the investment? Whether we like it or not, one reality that we all must face, and that this world is being ruled by money. And our whole system is based on investments. Amen. Now, an investment is when something of value is put into a venture, expecting to get more out of that venture than you put in. Amen. And recently, many investors lost everything they had when corporate executives of companies like Enron and the likes became too greedy, misquoted their corporate worth, and built their investors out of billions of dollars. And the little man, that's us, y'all. Those who work for these corporations, believed in these corporations. Some had their IRAs, their 401ks, and other retirement plans in place, looking forward to that day when they could walk out and tell them, you can have this job. But many have lost everything they invested, and they will never get a return on their investment. And whether you know it or not, everybody in here is continually making investments. Amen. And we are expecting to get returns on these investments. That's why when you are young, parents invest in you to go to school. Are you worth the investment? When you buy a home, that's one of the greatest investments you'll ever make. Amen. We invest time and energy in our jobs. We invest in automobiles. And you don't just go out and pick a car, but you ought to ask which car holds its value. Because many of us have bought cars that were not worth the investment. Can I get a witness here? We invest in relationships. And needless to say, is the fact that too many of us have made investments and have not gotten a return on your investment. And that's why so many of us are depressed right now. Because it's so depressing to know that you have invested so much, but get so little in return. And you keep asking the question, was it worth the investment? Then there are those of us who are not willing to invest very much, but you expect a big return on the little that you do invest. That's why the lottery is so successful. It promises that if you invest a little and just have it on the right number, come on somebody, then you will get astronomical returns on your meager investment. Talk to me, somebody. But let me tell you this. People who invest very little usually get very little in return. Amen. That's why when you go to school, if you don't invest the time, if you don't invest the study, come on somebody, then even if you do graduate, you will be a graduated dummy. Come on somebody. And if somebody discriminates against you because you are black, it's a shame. If somebody discriminates against you because you are a woman, it's a shame. But if somebody discriminates against you because you are dumb, that's your fault. You didn't invest enough. Amen. Some of us will not invest in our children what we need to invest. And we let the television raise our children. When we want to get them out of our hair, go watch television. And we don't invest the time in teaching our children right from wrong. And we're not teaching them a set of values that will carry them through life. You better take up some time with your children. Because if you don't, one day you'll wish you had invested a little more time. Amen. And if your relationship is going to thrive, amen, you got to do more than just be married. come home every day and eat and go to sleep. Marriages, relationships do not automatically work out. Oh, I wish I had a witness. You've got to be willing to invest something. You've got to give your emotions. Because when you don't, amen, you be like those guys that sing that song that your body is here with me, but your mind is on the other side of town. Talk to me, somebody. You've got to be willing to invest love. Amen. Not only love, but you got to be willing to invest of yourself. Come on, somebody. And investing of yourself doesn't mean that she's in the living room and you are in the bedroom, but I'm still here, ain't I? Y'all get mighty quiet on me now. No, don't, don't. You who plan on getting married, whatever you're investing now, you got to do it after you say I do. Come on, somebody. Because when you invest little, you get little. Am I doing all right, y'all? That, my brothers and sisters, is what happens when people become a part of the church. Many come, but they are not willing to invest very much. Amen. They are not willing to invest getting up on time. But you see, you have to be on time to go to work, or the boss is there watching. So we just get up when we wake up. Amen. And some of us, when we come to church, we don't even invest the attention that we need to pay. Oh, I wish I had a witness here. Some of us come in, sit down, go right to sleep. People who invest little will get little. That's why you ought to sing when you come to church. Because singing is praising God. And I see so many of us, while we're singing, we'll shut our mouth and won't say a word, as if to say, you can't make me sing. Well, nobody ought to try to make you sing. After God's done all that God has done for you, and you can't praise the Lord in song, stop worrying about how you sound. Man might laugh at you, but God looking at your heart. Invest your voice and sing God's praises. Oh, I wish I had a witness here. Some of us, coming to church is just a waste of time. Some just come so folk can say, at least they were there. Some come because your wife been arguing, begging, pleading. Come on, somebody. And sometimes the young men, when they see somebody they like, they will come to church. Y'all talk to me now. I mean, you can't fool me. When I was young, I did it too. I young woman I wanted to get next to. Well, let me move on here. Amen. Let me tell you this. Anything that you value highly, you will put much into it because you believe in it. Can I get a witness here? If you believe in your relationship, you'll invest something in it. If you believe in your child, you'll invest something. If you believe in your car, you'll invest something. And if you believe in the Lord, you'll invest something. And I'm afraid that God and God's church doesn't mean very much to many of us. Because you can tell by the investment we're willing to make. Preach right. What other venture do you invest so little and get so much? Amen. Some of us only invest $3 a week. Well, I wish I had a witness here. And $10 on a very good week. Amen. Suppose you took $10 to your rent man. I called the car note folks and said, I only got $10. Preach right. Your rent man will put you out. Your car man will take his car. Come on, somebody. And yet, God never turns out his sunshine and never stops you from breathing, and you are still willing to invest so little. Oh, I wish I had a witness here. Invest so little time. I'm going to spend 2 hours here. And if Reb ain't through, I'm leaving anyhow. Talk to me, somebody. And anything that you do that's worthwhile takes time. Can I get a witness here? Suppose the one that you love came to you every week, an hour late, looking at the watch all the time they're here at your house, and then leave an hour and a half and tell you, don't forget, I love you. And you will say, how can you love me? You never come when you say you're going to come. And all while you're here, you're looking at your watch. And then you leave before we, well, anyway, you. I wish I had a witness here. Is that not the way we do the Lord? We come in late, watch the clock. Oh, I wish I had a witness. And leave soon. And go out and say, church don't mean like it used to mean to me. Something wrong. Could it be that your investment is not very much? But when God's church means something, you'll invest your money. A tenth? Come on, somebody. Amen. And you put that money on the table and say, I wish I had more to give. Oh, I wish I had a witness here. Whatever the church needs, because it's been so good to me, I'm going to do everything I can to help the church, because there's somebody else like me that needs help, and I'll do it. Because I know when I do it for the church, I'm doing it for the Lord. Amen, somebody. Now notice what Jesus says in the text. He says, lay not up for yourselves treasures on earth, where thieves break in and where moth corrupt. That was the day, the way Jesus spoke in his day. Bringing that to today's time, you could say, lay not up for yourselves treasures on earth, where fires like the fire in California can burn it all down. And even though you have money, you'll be homeless. Come on, I wish I had a witness. Laying up treasures in your investments, and your investments give you no return. Amen. Does Jesus mean that you're not to look out for the future? No. Because he always says that whenever there is waste, want follows. So you ought to be wise when you get your little money. Come on, somebody. You ought to do what you're supposed to do for God first. And what's left, don't run off and spend it in everything. Save it, it's all right. But don't get hung up on riches of this world, because thieves will take it. I wish I had a witness here. Now don't you think, because you got a couple of $1,000 in the bank, that you're doing all right. One little sickness can wipe it out. Can I get a witness here? Your corporation that you work for, that you got 23 years at, can go bankrupt a year before you retire. But Jesus says, but rather lay up treasures in heaven. Because one thing folk can't rob you of, your reward in heaven. How do I lay up treasure? Well, the way I lay up treasure in heaven is what you do for others, you do it for the Lord. And every time you try to help somebody, you're laying up treasure. Many of you heard me tell the story about this rich man that died, and he did go to heaven, but he was arrogant. And he got to heaven, he saw those mansions that Jesus had talked about. And because he had so much on the earth, the first thing he did, he went to the biggest mansion he saw and said, I presume this is my mansion. The boy said, no. What about that one? No. That one? No. Which one? And they showed him a house not much bigger than a doghouse. He said, there must be some mistake. Do you know who I am? I started a business from nothing, and I made it into a giant corporation. We were on the Fortune 500. We were on the U.S. Stock Exchange. And you give me a doghouse? I'm not used to such. And when he saw he could not prevail, said, I'll go, but tell me, whose mansion is this? And the boy said, you remember Sister Mary? You mean that poor, crazy woman always trying to help folks? That's the one. Always cooking for folk, going down to, that's the one. Now wait a minute. How can she get a mansion like this? And you give me a doghouse. And the boy said to him, while you were busy making your millions, amen, you didn't sin up very much for the Lord. In other words, you invested very little in the Lord. Amen, somebody. But every time Sister Mary tried to help somebody, she was making an investment. She said, you see, we got to build these houses on what you sent up. You sent very little, but every time Sister Mary helped somebody, she was sending up some timber. That's why when you see me going all the time, it's not all about the money. I'm just sending up some timber. Sometimes when you're sending up timber, it means you have to go when you don't want to go. You have to give even when you don't have it to give. You got to praise when you don't feel like praising. Those of us who value our relationship with God, you will know that God gives you a big return on your investment. Can I get a witness here? Do you know that as a child of God, you get benefits when you make an investment? And David looked at what the Lord had done for him. And brothers and sisters, let me tell you this. God made a big investment in you. When you couldn't help yourself, God gave your parents and guardians to watch over you. God was making an investment. When you couldn't read or write, God gave you teachers to teach you how to read and write. God was making an investment. Oh, I wish I had a witness here. And when debt would have claimed your life, God was making an investment to you. And I want to know, are you worth some of us? God has invested time, gifts, and talent in us, and are we using it? No, we are not worth the investment. Some of us, God gave good voices, invested that voice in you, and you won't even use it. Some of y'all look at me like you're getting mad here now. Some of you, God has given so many gifts, but what are you doing with it? Nothing. Why not? Nobody asked me. Come on, somebody. Well, if you don't get your check on time, do you say, nobody gave it to me? No, you go down to the office and say, where's my check? Come on, somebody. God gave you a gift. Don't just wait for somebody to ask you. Volunteer sometime. Can I get a witness here? God didn't give it to you just to lie dormant. And I want you to ask yourself now, am I worth the investment? But David recognized that when you're willing to give God what belongs to God, your return is very great. And David was so happy over his benefits that he said in the 116th Psalm, what shall I render unto the Lord for all of his benefits toward me? Let me tell you something. When you're a child of God, you get benefits. Now everybody gets general benefits. He lets the sun shine on the just and the unjust. Everybody get a general benefit. He'll let you breathe without sending you a breathing bill. But there are some special things that when you're a child of God, he'll give you benefits. Yeah, Lord. And that benefit, many times, is contingent on what you do. So then, Jesus said, if you abide in me, and my word abides in you, you can ask what you will in my name, and I'll give it to you. That's a benefit. Can I get a witness? He'll give you another benefit. Bring into my house tithes and offerings, and you'll get a great benefit. I'll pour out the windows of heaven so many blessings that you won't be able to handle all of them. That ain't nothing but a benefit. And when I woke up early this morning, I had a benefit, because that let me know the Lord had stationed an angel by my bedside and told that angel to watch over me all night long. Nothing but a benefit. And when I woke up this morning, I was clothed and in my right mind. I knew my name. I didn't try to put my shoes on my head. It wasn't nothing but a benefit. And I'm afraid many of us are taking God's benefit and won't even tell him thank you. That's why we come to God's house. We've come to praise the Lord. If you start praising him on your job, your manager will come out and tell you, you can't act like that here. Can I get a witness here? If you praise the Lord in the public schools, they'll want to lock you up, because we can't call on God's name in the school. I wish I had a witness here. But the one place where you can come, where there are others of like mind, of like spirit, there are others that know the Lord been good to me. When I come to church, I can praise him and nobody's gonna put me out. David said, what shall I render unto the Lord for all of his benefits? One thing that you can invest today, and it doesn't cost you any money, doesn't cost you much time, but invest your praise in the Lord. In other words, you ought to be a witness. The Lord been good to me. Anybody know he been good? Anybody know the Lord brought you from a mighty long way? I want to tell you what you do now. Invest a little praise in it. Go on and give him the praise. And the Lord, won't he bless your soul? And I don't know about you. I don't have to be in church to invest a lot of praise. I praise him while driving along. I praise him when I wake up in the morning. I tell him, thank you. So when you see me and I'm getting happy, don't say something must be wrong with him. Don't call me ignorant. But I'm just thinking about how good the Lord been to me. You who are here today, I want you to focus on what the Lord has done for you. Not 20 years ago, but this week. If the Lord been good to you, praise him. Don't you ever take God's blessings for granted. Every time you get in your automobile and get from one destination to another, it was the Lord that kept you. Every time, I feel all right in here now. Every time God give you a special blessing, you ought to not take the credit. Just say, to God be the glory. Hallelujah. This week, when we got on that plane, 3 hours later, we were down in Puerto Rico. And I said, Lord, it wasn't the pilot. It was you. And when that plane hit the ground, in my spirit, I said, thank you. Yesterday afternoon, we went to another plane, a plane that I never saw, a pilot that I didn't know. But I wasn't putting my faith in that pilot. I said, Lord, you are in control. And when that plane hit the runway yesterday, I said, thank you. Do you have anything that the Lord has done for you this week? You ought to tell him thank you. Listen, here's what I want you to do. Will you do me a favor? I want you to think of one blessing that the Lord's done for you this week. And then I want you to tell the person next to you what the Lord did for you this week. Go and tell them right now. And when you get through telling them, then you listen to them. Let them tell you what the Lord has done for you. Has he made a way? Has he been a friend? Has he held your hand? Tell him, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Now notice this. When I ask you to tell somebody what the Lord done for you, I was just asking you to make a benefit. Just asking you to make an investment. But then some of you wouldn't even say a word. You wouldn't even make an investment. You couldn't tell somebody what the Lord done for you. I'm going to ask you one more time. Tell them one blessing that God has given you this week. Yes! Yes! Oh, yes! Praise him! Praise him! Praise him! But when praises go up, won't blessing come on down? Don't you feel better now since you've been praising the Lord? Won't he give you joy? Clapping in your hand, running in your feet, joy! Gone and praise, gone and praise. Somebody gonna tell you. No need of you acting up like that. That's not sophisticated. But you remember David? When the Ark of the Covenant had been found, everybody in Israel were rejoicing in the Lord. David got to dancing. He danced so hard, he danced out of his clothes. When he got back home, his wife told him, "You embarrassed me today." All of the women in Israel saw you act like a donkey. David said, "If you think that's something, you wait till tonight. When we go to praise the Lord again, I'm gonna praise him." Now somebody in your home will criticize you for going to church so much. Somebody in your home will criticize you for praising the Lord. They'll tell you, "I notice you praise the Lord, but I still see you do something wrong." Tell them, "I might get wrong sometime, but that doesn't stop the Lord from blessing me. I don't care when I'm wrong, I'm gonna praise him because he's been good." Anybody know he?
Subscribe to Brother Rollins Videos for Christ on YouTube. We post brand new content every week with powerful preaching from ministers and pastors all across the nation that seek to encourage people all over the world through the word of Jesus Christ. You will also find gospel songs and old-time hymns that have inspired generations of Christians. Subscribe today and hit the bell so you never miss new content. YouTube.com/Brother Rollins. Spell it. B-R-O-T-H-A Rollins. Brother Rollins Videos for Christ on YouTube.